Welcome Eliot Peper on stage to introduce our first panel.
Why don't you guys all come up? Got one right here. Why don't you guys, we'll all come up. You can join me. As an author, I sort of feel like I'm on Game of Thrones right now.
That is so sweet.
I know. It's pretty incredible. So thank you all for coming out tonight. Ari and the entire Tech Mixer team here, thanks so much for having us. It's really a great pleasure, and we've got some really, really cool people that I'm excited to introduce you to. The topic of our discussion is going to be alternative ways to work in the 21st century. And this is a topic that's pretty close to my heart. Actually, ever since university, I've worked independently. So I actually haven't had a W-2 in years. And I did that as an early stage employee at a couple different startups by co-founding my own, and then as an entrepreneur in residence at a VC firm down in San Diego. And now I'm an author of Uncommon Stock, so you guys will get the excerpt. But what I think is really interesting is that when you look out in the world, and in particular the professional world, things have changed a lot. In fact, I was just talking to Cammy, one of our panelists here earlier this evening, and her father worked at the same company and loved it for 35 years. And when you look at the world 20 years ago, I think that the model for success was a little bit more straightforward. If you went to a good school, if you then worked hard and tried to work for a blue chip company, you could climb that career ladder and you would achieve that version of success. And I think that today, what's really interesting is when you look out there, you'll see certain people with the right connections and track record that you can't pay enough money to hire. Right, and we have friends who are graphic designers and programmers who work from a beach in Thailand, right? And at the same time, when new people come and try to enter the workforce for the first time, whether they're coming out of college, whether they're quitting their job to start a company, it's really confusing because it's not necessarily clear how you actually get in on that, right? And so our hope today is that we've gotten together a pretty diverse set of people who are all doing incredible, incredible things and doing them very, very differently. So I'm hoping that, I'm looking forward to learning from them, and I'm hoping that we can all learn from them together, and I'll ask them a few questions, we'll have a conversation, and then we'll take a bunch of Q&A from the audience. So to get started, Eric is the CEO of Modular Robotics. And Eric is particularly interesting because he went to architecture school and then started a robotics company, which is not the usual path for becoming after you get an architectural degree. And he's also running the company quite differently. When I visited their manufacturing center in Boulder, which he established there instead of China, how many dogs do you have in the office?
6 or 8, usually on any given day.
There we go. I don't know if any of you guys have been to a robot manufacturing center before, but that was the first time I'd ever seen a golden retriever. And then Jessica is the CEO of the Passion Company here in San Francisco, and she actually has a very interesting perspective because her entire business is about helping many, many people transfer out of the corporate world and into the creative world. And so I think we're going to be able to draw not only on your wisdom, but of all the people whose lives you touch. Cammy, on this side, is Techstars founder is this the first time you've talked about giving goods publicly?
It is.
Okay, so we'll save that for a little later in the conversation, but we do have some news today, which I'm actually really excited to learn from. And she's an incredible founder and moved out of consulting to start an e-commerce company that was very mission-driven. So I think there are a lot of good lessons there. And then Ryan, here on my right, built the number one productivity app on the App Store. And we won't tell you how old he is. We promised we wouldn't.
Is that what you decided to do with that?
you told me not to.
I said you
And I think what's really interesting here is that Ryan has some great perspectives, not only on productivity and design, which I want to hear about, but also just on living your own life differently, which is sort of what a lot of our first conversation was about, how you approach your own education and how you approach your career. So with that, let's get started. The first thing that I would like to know is, why don't you have a corporate job? So maybe Jessica, let's start with you.
Well, I still have one.
Oh, even better. Okay. So what? But you did share something with me.
Yeah. Not for long, which I'm leaving. Well, to start with, my definition of success when I was younger, and the way I think we're all raised, is about how much money you're going to make and status. So you're in a company, can you get to the top of the ladder? And eventually, I hit all the check boxes and I got to go to one of the best business schools, got the best jobs, work at the hottest startup, and I was still miserable. So I asked myself, really, what is success to me? And I started realizing that a lot of people are asking themselves, what is success? And eventually, I came to see that it is okay that success for you is doing what you love, is doing something that brings you meaning. And that's something that I'm seeing with everyone from different social classes, from different types of jobs, is people are questioning again, why am I going down this path? And it was similar for me, and that's why I'm quitting my job to focus on the passion company, because it is, for me, success is helping others find their passions. So it is definitely a personal question that you have to answer away from the other people's expectations.
That's very cool. And so you moved from consulting to Given Goods, right? Mm-hmm. So what sparked that transition, and what were you looking for?
I think I didn't know that I wasn't looking to work corporately. Mm. That really wasn't it. I just ran really hard and fast towards what I was looking for. And I guess when we were talking about this question a little bit more, that's my biggest takeaway. It has very little to do with how you define the place in which you work as a startup or a big corporation, but go hard at the thing that you want. No one was running the type of company that we wanted to run. No one was selling the products I was looking for in the way that I wanted to buy them. And so that goal was really what sent me out of consulting, out of agency work, out of a paycheck pretty quickly, and really good dental insurance, and into running Given Goods, which I think was the definition of what I had hoped for.
I feel like I need to pass. I do work a corporate job. It's kind of like a corporate job with a little bit of my own design input in it, but it's a corporate job.
Okay.
And I love it.
And what drove you to start in the first place?
Oh, to start Modular Robotics? I didn't know what else I wanted to do. We had built some robotic systems in school, and people kept coming by our lab and saying, hey, I want to buy that. Hey, would you make an extra one? What about if we gave you $1,000? Would you make another one for our science center? And when you hear that enough and you don't have anything else to do, it seemed like a really good idea to just try and fulfill that.
That's great.
I don't have a real grown-up job, is kind of an interesting angle. So basically, my friend Michael and I built this app called Finish, which is a kind of like iOS task management type tool that's ended up doing really, really awesome. And So I actually came up with a concept when I was studying for finals back in school, and it's interesting because it was just a very direct like problem that I wanted to solve for myself. And it was one where, like, you know, I was stressed about classes and finals and grades, and my friends were too, and I had used a lot of different productivity tools and different apps and, you know, different our school planner and all that stuff, and really thought there was room for something that's really kind of geared around students. And it just turned into, we decided to build it to see if we could, and kind of launched it, and it ended up just getting a way, way more traction than we were expecting, and we kind of just went with it. So yeah.
Okay. So what are you looking to do now?
Yeah. So I'm really, really interested in a couple spaces. Still working on Finish. Still growing Finish. We actually launched a free version back in. Is it kind of feedbacky? A little bit.
It is a little.
Maybe. Hold up.
Am I good? Yeah, that's better. Speak louder. I can do that. Okay. So we actually launched a free version back in March, which was, you know, a huge spike in the charts, and we've seen really good adoption of that so far. But I'm really, really interested in both motivational software and the education space, especially the education space. So what's really... Actually, here, I'll save this for like a later, longer question.
Okay.
But yeah, really interested in kind of the ed tech and education space.
Okay, so you know, you brought up an interesting point, which is when you're trying to decide what you want to do or how you want to do it, you better have a goal in mind, right? And that's it sounds like what everyone here has been executing against. So, you know, with that, I think that all of you guys have really interesting examples of non-standard 21st century jobs. So for people in this room, what does a career mean in the 21st century? What is a 21st century job?
Well, I have a story for you. Is that working? Yeah. Actually, I spent over a year interviewing 100 people doing what they love full time. And one of the funniest jobs that I came across was a cuddle therapist. He was actually doing really well. I did not invest, but because he was scaling his business and just so that I think is just an example of the new economy is basically people are going and pursuing a lot of people are something that they're passionate about, and the trend that I saw is people pursue it in a form of a passion project. So you do have your Google job, but on the side, you're doing cuddling therapy. And eventually, your cuddling therapy picks up. Then you leave Google and you become a venture-funded cuddling therapy company. So that's actually how I see it. I see it as like our people are actually taking the chance in their free time to pursue something that's unconventional, unexpected, and with time it grows into a business, hopefully.
So you've seen so many people do this.
Yeah.
So is there any, because it seems like there were, I'm sure not all of those 100 people were doing cuddle therapy, right?
No.
So of the people who you interviewed, and what cut across them? You know, you said they're doing what they love, and they've turned that into making a living, right? So was there anything that you noticed in interviewing these 100 people that was a variable that was standardized?
Absolutely. So the first thing that I talked about, which is they all started on the side. So it's not about, it's rarely ever about quitting everything, dropping and going to Bali and the Eat, Pray, Love model. And the other thing is that they had supportive community, which we kind of talked about a little bit. But it's not supportive community, your friends, because sometimes your friends are not going to support you in pursuing your passion, including my parents did not. It's about having people who are actually cheering you on while you're pursuing your passion, and that comes from creating vulnerable relationships. So it's not we see a lot in Silicon Valley, the networking. It's about creating a meaningful relationship where you share your fears and more than that. And the third thing is what we like to call self-love, is about really allowing yourself to dream, forgiving yourself when you fail, and being in touch with who you really are. It's sometimes scary to go there, but it's essential.
So, Cammy, did you start giving goods on the side?
I did start giving goods on the side. Yep, it was very much this doesn't exist, and can it exist type of project when it first started. So lots of late nights, lots of trying to get in touch with people, lots of Googling. and many, many, many unknowns.
And what was the moment when you decided to take the leap?
It's funny. I feel like a lot of people have this epiphany about how awesome their business is going to be or a thing that happens. I mostly just got to the point where I wanted to spend a lot more time on giving goods than I was spending doing anything else. And it was a very passion-driven project, but it also, there came a moment where I knew I kind of needed a force mechanism, which... Mm-hmm. is a little bit of a different way to think about when to leave your job. Because I felt as though we weren't gonna get the best work done if we were still continuing to do it just at night and into the morning and then into the early morning. It was more to say, get your ass out there and actually do the thing.
Got it. So Ryan, you built a very, very popular productivity app. Have you noticed anything about your own productivity? Like, you did that on the side. Like, what have you learned about human productivity as a universal truth?
I don't know if I really have any universal truths on human productivity. But one thing that I pay a lot of attention to in kind of like software design and in productivity is that on pretty much any piece of software, you have this ratio between like amount of like cognitive load and like mental energy you need to put into the thing kind of at the top of the funnel, whether it's adding a task or putting in your calendar event or writing your note or whatever like that software is meant to do, and then how much actual value and benefit you can derive out of that. Like, and that's something that, you know, if you have to spend 5 minutes, you know, in a productivity tool, adding a task, setting up a task, and then it doesn't really save you any more than just reminding you that there's a much better way to balance that. What we really focus on with Finish is this kind of like automated system where your stuff is always moving up through like these three time frames that we have. And the idea is that with a really, really simple amount of energy expended up at the top of the funnel at the beginning, you know, just a name and a due date, we do a lot of kind of like getting rid of the annoying metacognition around your stuff for you. And that's something that I've like really paid a lot of attention to, especially with students. When you get into that loop of like, I have like 50 things and I don't know when to start any of them and I'm tired and I want to go eat ice cream. And we all get into that loop. And it's simply because there's all this essentially like meta information around your task of time and how it relates to other tasks and how stressed you actually are about it and all that. And none of that is stuff that you should really have to think about, because it's honestly all pretty straightforward stuff of this and this and this and this. But when you have your own brain have to focus on that, it gets really loopy and nasty. And being able to essentially like, you know, outsource that to a, you know, your phone or some other piece of hardware and have it manage as much of kind of the like everything except for the actual thing around it, we think is really, really valuable. And it just frees you up to be able to, you know, just focus much more clearly. So that's kind of my angle on a lot of that. And it's something I see a lot with students.
Great. Yeah, thank you. And then
I would kind of build on that a little bit on super meta level of, you know, kind of going back to what does a 21st century job look like? I have no idea, but I do think it changes.
None of us do.
I think it changes a lot, right? It's not 35 years Kodak. It changes a lot. And personally, I feel really lucky that my job has changed a lot. You know, a few years ago, it was just me in a garage making tiny robots, and then there were a couple people, and now there are 60 of us, and it's kind of insane. And I recommend a tip and a tactic for the changing job landscape, and it has to do with a simple little chart that I make every Friday. And it's a little XY-axis chart, right? On the bottom, you do things that I'm really bad at and things that I'm really good at. And then on the y-axis, you do things that I really don't enjoy versus things that I really do enjoy. And this is how we decide who to hire at Modular Robotics. You start to take your whole week's worth of stuff that you did and put a little point cloud in the graph and see where you are. And if you're kind of trending to the upper right quadrant, well, good for you, you're all right. But if you're doing most of the stuff in the lower left, maybe it's time to kind of make some changes. So when we first got venture capital and decided to hire people, we went and made that graph, and finance and supply chain and dealing with overseas vendors were clearly in the lower left, so they were the first two people that we hired. You know, but I think a lot of times for, you know, productivity, we're kind of doing a lot of the wrong stuff, and we're doing a lot of the stuff that's not necessarily with the best trajectory or the things that can get our business forward or do like the absolute best thing. So being clear and present and figuring out the landscape of stuff that you need to do really helps.
Yeah, that's really powerful. Now, if you are on the bottom left side of the graph too often, what do you do?
You get kind of depressed. I mean, luckily for me, I have the flexibility to kind of hire and change my job on a day-to-day basis. But I think if you're honest with yourself and you're in the lower left-hand quadrant of the graph, it's probably time to do something else before you get hit by a bus.
All right, so let's say you really don't want to get hit by that bus, right? So you do switch it up and you want to change what you're doing, whether that's striking out on your own in some form, finding a new job, what have you. You know, I feel like one of the things that's so difficult about making those kinds of decisions is that it's an unknown, right? Like you're stepping into a dark room and you don't know what's next. If you did know what was next, might make it a lot easier, right? But like that level of uncertainty is really challenging and can be terrifying, right? So all of you guys have done that. You've all forged your path in some kind of a way. So how do you deal or live with uncertainty? And why don't we start with you?
I mean, you have to, right? You don't have another choice. Uncertainty is like physics. You can't overcome it. You know, it's just there. You kind of have to do that. And my view in an uncertain scenario is somebody's controlling something. Somebody's controlling everything, right? If you have a bunch of uncertainty in front of you and you don't know what to do, do you want to give it to some junior manager at Google or something like that who might control what happens, or sign up to work on somebody else's business who might be managing it poorly and then it's going to be closed and you're going to be out of a job? Or do you want to take as much possible control of an uncertain environment and kind of affect the change that you can do? It's like investing in the stock market versus investing in like real estate that you might fix up yourself. I would much rather, you know, kind of do option B, because then you have control. You know, I'd always rather have control. Whenever I tell people I work in tiny robots, there's like 75% of the world that says, "Oh my God, they're going to come and take us over and kill us while we sleep." And I don't think that's true. I don't think that's. People want to talk about that, and then they want to talk about robot sex, which is better than the 75% of like robots that will kill us in our sleep. But like, yeah, you know, people are making evil, scary robots and going and killing people with them. But I'd rather at least be on the side of designing the robots than sitting there and waiting for them to come get us in their sleep. So, you know.
So you make tiny robots that kill people in their sleep?
No, play robots, toy robots.
Right.
Cuddling robots.
Cuddling robots, nice.
We could probably do a whole panel.
Yeah, you should meet this guy. Yeah.
Speaking of cuddling. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because I grew up during the war, and I, for me, uncertainty is other people's certainty. So when things are certain, I panic. But going back to why, like a lot of us are scared of uncertainty, is underneath this is a fundamental fear, and being really aware of your fears and comfortable with them, like creating that connection, has been very helpful on a personal level for me to start a company. So whenever I notice that I'm using excuses, I go back and ask, why am I using this excuse? Oh, the deck is not ready. It's because I'm afraid. And then what am I afraid of? Oh, I'm afraid of failing. Okay, let me just be with that feeling, but keep going. So a lot of the time, uncertainty is just surface level, and connection and awareness is the way to go through it and do.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's very powerful. So, I guess something
I kind of have a little bit of a different angle on the whole uncertainty thing, because, so for a little bit of background, so I just graduated high school, and you wanted to say that. Okay. So what's kind of the interesting thing about that is that I'm at a point where I haven't had that much room to actually make a decision that could, you know, matter some number of years down the line. Because other than like, you know, doing Finnish and that kind of thing, kind of been doing the normal school route. And it's that, you know, like at 16 or 17, you haven't made that many decisions really, like yourself. Like it sounds weird, but like I haven't decided that much that's really affected like the trajectory of my life other than like starting this thing. And realizing that I'm now in a place where like I have multiple options on the table of, you know, next things to do, further things to do with Finnish, you know, do I raise money, do I work here, do I do this, blah, blah, blah. Like, being in that place and realizing, like, not only are these, like, legitimate decisions from a company perspective, but they're also, like, I haven't really decided anything that would matter in 10 years yet. And that's, like, a weird feeling that I'm trying to think of as more than just, like, ah, shit, there's a bunch of pressure. But, like, I think that the like feedback loop you get from major decisions is not really something you can like learn in any sort of artificial environment. And you kind of just have to make a bunch of decisions and see what happens, and then just you get better at it, hopefully. Hopefully. I'm kind of counting on that. But yeah, it's a weird, I'm in kind of a weird place right now.
Unsolicited piece of advice.
Hit me.
For anybody else that
is making tiny robots to kill people, you were saying. No, here's what's interesting. Here's what's interesting. So I did not
go to college.
So I didn't do exceedingly well at the whole getting into college thing, but I actually have a couple friends who didn't get into the undergrad schools they wanted,
But some schools will actually let you go to grad school having not gone to undergrad. It's not really like a publicized thing, but I do know people who are doing it. It actually sounds kind of interesting.
The problem with that, though, is it, at least in my life, grad school was something, you know, after undergrad or something, I worked in architecture, and I didn't know what I wanted to do, and for a long time, for like 7 years, felt a lot of uncertainty, like we were talking about, oh, I don't know what I want to do with my life, I could do anything I want, but I just can't pick, et cetera. And after a long period of that, signing up to go to grad school is the most wonderful way to say to yourself, all right, I've got 3 to 5 years where I don't care anymore, it doesn't matter, I can be present, I can do this, I can build whatever I want, I can make some tiny robots or other cool shit and not worry about what's next. I'll figure that out when I'm done.
That's why college kind of is, that's how I see college too, though.
But grad school, you have like one option. So, you know, everybody needs to go to college and stuff, and then everybody has grad school as this like thing to do later, and if you stack it on at the end of college, then when you're done, you go into a career and you're like, oh, fuck, I hate all these people in this whole career. You don't have an option to go back and do something else. You've already done your grad school thing. But if you've still got grad school looming, you can be like, all right, fuck this consulting thing.
I would add a little bit to that, though, which is I have some friends who've had fantastic grad school experiences, and it's really gotten them where they've needed to go in their own honest knowledge of what came next after grad school. I also have friends, and for me, grad school would not have been a good idea because I would have kicked the can down the road on starting the thing I really, really wanted to start because I could have made excuses that I needed to know more or go take touchy-feely or go understand more about spreadsheets or something. And I don't know any of those things. And I've read a lot about touchy-feely, and it sounds awesome. But I think it was the right thing for my sort of my truth, if you will, to go and learn from doing. The part I was gonna bring up, Ryan and I went through Techstars essentially together last year. We tried very hard to make Ryan a...
They kind of adopted me. It was weird.
Part of giving kids in every way.
It was weird.
And you say that you haven't made many big decisions, but you also have great parents who have helped put you into a great
Cammy
situation.
Has this weird thing where she like really loves my mom and I just kind of go with it, but it's kind of weird.
But I think part of what is important that we learned or that I took away from Techstars last year was there's this concept of intellectual honesty. And a lot of what we're talking about, I think, applies to this idea that you just need to know what your find your way of navigating all of this. So if you really genuinely think that grad school is that right thing, hell yeah, go. Everyone in here, I'm sure, could get into schools I cannot get into. But I think that that's important to know about yourself. If you know and you have to face that truth that you are gonna get into grad school and just kick the fucking can, don't go. But force yourself to make that choice.
I think that's really interesting and powerful. Actually, I've given the same advice, like don't go to grad school, to many of my friends. And
as have I.
Yeah, and I
should just clarify, I recommend you do go to grad school.
Sure.
I loved it. It was like cathartic.
Yeah, I had a great time too.
But just wait a little while so that you can have a crisis before going to grad school.
And I think I think that that's really key because for two reasons. One is that
crisis grad school.
Right, because like it's a great comeback from a crisis, right? Like it's this little parachute you can always pull. But the second piece is that by having more experience before going, you're actually going to be able to better choose what you might enjoy. I'm one of the people you mentioned who went straight from undergrad to grad school. And it was, I had convinced myself that I wanted to do academic research in international environmental policy, which to me sounded cool, but in practice was really depressing because you were sort of studying a lot of why the Kyoto Protocol doesn't work. And reading a lot of academic papers about that. And it was interesting, but it was really not the right fit for me. And so halfway through grad school, I realized this and quit my job doing that research and started working for a startup. And now that startup is sort of interesting because we did a product demo. They were making large pieces of waste-to-energy equipment. And I actually remember I'd been climbing around on this machine all day long, and we were outside because you have to do it at a waste facility, right? And I was in like business garb that had oil just all over it, And we had flown in investors and customers and government officials from all over the world. And so they were all here for this demo. And so they're all, like, dozens of them are sort of a semicircle around this big machine. And, you know, we have our little fun countdown. We're filming it so that we can make a little product demo out of it. And when we turn it on, it exploded. Like actual, like roiling smoke.
All the waste everywhere?
Like, no, thankfully that was contained, but like just roiling black smoke, like going into the, I mean, it was sort of terrifying, and you guys can probably guess we didn't have a warm reception from all the folks that we had brought down there. But that brings me to something else, and I really want to hear about this from you guys, and that is, how do you deal with failure, right? I mean, like, that's a really tough thing to deal with, and that's something we had to struggle through. And it's something that sometimes people are, it's hard to touch on, and it's hard to actually talk about directly, because it's personal, right? Like, it has emotional impacts, not just sort of, I don't know, professional ones. And it's something that everyone has to wrestle with, but it's difficult to address. So with that, I actually want to ask Cammy to tell us a little bit about Given Goods. And for you guys here, because failure can be really difficult to talk about, this is the first time, Cammy, you're going to talk about what happened to Given Goods. And so pay attention, because this is pretty cool. And I'm really thrilled that you can share this story with us. I was blessed to hear it a few days ago.
So I think I'm sitting in the unique position up here of having a company that I have just shut down. And I'm very, very good at smiling through this, and I'm very, very
good
at
weirdly good
being excited about the good parts of what I did and what we didn't win at. I think I'm not dealing with it that well, interestingly. And I say that in the most honest way, because you won't deal with it well. You don't get to put your heart and your soul and all of your love into a thing and have it not work and go away from you. I don't have a job right now. I am I'm learning a lot more, I think, even still today, but I'm so grateful for how hard this moment is, because I went for it, mostly. And I think I'm maybe sometimes better at it than at other times. I'm maybe smiling a little bit more than at other times. But I think you deal with failure because at least you put yourself out there to be able to do it. Mm-hmm. And I love that about this moment. At least we did it. And I think there are, you know, a million quotes. People have loved sending me wonderful things in this moment, motivationally speaking and otherwise. But I wouldn't take any of it back. I wouldn't take how shitty I feel sometimes right now back. And just feeling like I really miss my company. And then I really miss what we were doing. But I'm glad we did it. And I hope you will. If you're here sitting, listening to this and trying to figure out, do you want to take that step off of whatever cliff you're looking at, however big, however small, and then you fall flat on your face like I have just done, you'll find a lot of friends along the way. People will make sure your heart's in the right place no matter what. And we just shut down my company, and I'm still here able to talk to you about it. And I am lovingly accepting hugs right now. And really,
cuddle
really...
Therapy.
Cuddle therapy. Except I think I want to be a cuddle therapist now.
Can we ask what that actually is?
Yeah, we can talk about it. We can do a cuddle session.
But I'd like to talk about it with anybody who wants to know. It's a really hard and fantastic part of my journey, and I'll probably do it again a bunch of times, frankly. So I'm getting some practice.
Going off of that kind of that whole cliff thing, have any of you guys heard of a guy named Brett Victor? And he gave a talk called Inventing on Principle, which kind of went around the internet like a year or so ago.
Talking to your mic.
Talking to my mic. So I don't know if anyone's watched this talk, but it's actually amazing. He's this crazy kind of UI UX theorist who I'm a huge fan of. But basically what he talks about is that there's a lot you hear about like going to find your passion and stuff, and like that's not that helpful for the most part, because to me those type of like inspiring-y things tend to be like abstracted and broadened to the extent that they're not really actionable. And like if you were to look at like someone's process of finding their passion and try to like write that up and like divert it into a bunch of little steps that you could then send around to people and be like, do this, and then you find it. Because you can't really do that, I don't think that the angle should be trying to tell people to find their passion as to the extent of like, so what this inventing on principle talk talked about, and I won't like redo it, but basically his gist of it was that like find your thing that's like a fundamental, like essentially like a fundamental wrong that you want to essentially devote yourself to fixing that fundamental wrong. With him and with his crazy awesome, crazy mind-blowing user interface stuff, it's all about like building design tools and developer tools where creators have a direct connection to what they're creating and they can always see what they're doing. And that's like his principle, and that's kind of like what he devotes himself to and tries to build any software he can to like further that principle. With me, so it's really hard to find yours. And I think because there's not a great feedback loop for it, because you have to expend so much energy into like really, really like devoting yourself to something, it takes a while to figure out if it's really the thing. With me, that like wrong that I see is kind of the broken feedback loops in high schools and how you have, depending on which annoying census number you take, 14 or 17 million high school students in the US, and the societal norm is that most of them hate it, and you know it's normal to hate high school, that's kind of expected, and that's the case. But the fact that we're all cool with that is like fundamentally really weird to me, and that's a space I'm really, really interested in. From a, so in high schools, there's all these crazy, what?
Are you saying that like the route to finding your passion is to actually find a problem that you really care about?
Yeah, like a broad problem.
Like so yeah.
Yeah,
so
yeah. No, totally.
Take our program. So I think you're absolutely right. The way it's romanticized is what we're trying to fix. It's basically what you were saying about fixing a problem is meaning. So passions, they could be hundreds and thousand of ways you could express your meaning. It could be within your current job. It could be starting a business. It could be volunteering. But it's about knowing what really brings you meaning. And there's different things. Like for me, it's self-expression. For your UI, UX designer, it's fixing problems. And I want to rebuild the way education is done, where when you're in high school, it's not even high school, you're learning about what really fulfills you, and you're going and testing around doing, basically, instead of sitting and learning in class. And doing is absolutely the right way to go from even younger age. I met this, actually my friend Liz here met this couple, and she told me that story about their little girl who was 14, and what they do is they travel with her. She got interested into food and cooking, so they went to Italy, and she doesn't go to school. She studied with a chef. And that's what they do. They literally follow where her desire goes. And so when you start doing, you start failing, which is absolutely beautiful, because failure is just something that you get trained on. But when you, if you are type A, you never fail, because you're always top of your class. And so basically by doing and doing something that you don't know much about is when you fail. And the more you fail, the more you get used to it. It still sucks, but you still get used to it. And I always remember that all the best companies or the most inspiring people, they failed so many times. So you gotta keep going is the other thing. So whatever next you're gonna do, you gotta keep going. You can't stop.
This is a really awesome discussion. I love passion. And the passion you guys bring to this floor right now is really awesome. And you're starting at such a young space. It's really, really cool. And I'd like to open up questions to the audience that may want to ask some questions of these guys here. Just a show of hands if you have a question you'd like to ask one of the panelists. Here we go up front. I'll be right with you.
Hi, this is for Cammy. I'm Bing. And I was listening to you talk very openly about shutting down your business. I'm just curious what led to that decision.
Many things. Certainly, we made some hard choices that were sort of 110% versus 50% type of choices. And I think my co-founder and I looked very seriously at how we wanted to run the company, and we decided, you know, we're going to leave it all out on the field, basically. We're either going to really win or we're going to really lose. And we went through a fair amount of trying to raise money. We went through some diligence processes to sell the company, and we came up shorthanded on all those things. So it was a financial decision, and I think at the end of the day, we had to be so honest with ourselves about just how much more of that battle we were truly willing to fight. And we'd been fighting, it's been a great 3 years. And I think we said, all right, we're where we can be with what we said we were going to be doing for these investors and this company, and called it what it was and left it out on the field, which I recommend. Thank you. And I'm happy to chat more about it too.
Hello. Hi, my name's Tom. I'm in the process of kind of debating on switching from tech to photography. And so the question I have is kind of for the whole panel. If you had to ask, if you were in my shoes, what 3 to 5 questions would you ask yourself in order to figure out if you should make the jump?
So I liked your chart earlier. Maybe you can tackle this one.
But 3 to 5 questions. So I'd make the chart, and probably assuming that photography and doing your own photography is in the upper right-hand quadrant of the chart, and doing whatever you're doing in a tech company is maybe somewhere in the other 3/4. I mean, it sounds like you've already asked yourself the questions.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I don't have any smart questions for you, but just do it. I mean, you might be the guy in this room that gets hit by the bus in the next year.
You know?
And I hope not. I hope I didn't mean to like be morbid with that, but you might, right? And what are you doing now in San Francisco, working for a company that makes sure that your Twitter's automatically RSS your blog to your something else and everything? Like, fuck that noise. Just quit and just do it, and it's gonna be awesome.
Yeah. What is this? I would just talking practically, what I did is I did my what I needed to survive money, and I said, can I make it with my side business? Because I, by letting go, I had to let go of my Gucci bag. I never had one, but my Prada bag. And that's one. Number two, surround yourself with other people in that same transition. And people who are full-time photographers. Community is it. It takes a village to do what you're doing, and you have a lot of courage for doing it.
And you can always go back. You can always, always go get a job or do whatever it is that you were doing. I would try it even. But I would try it 110%, really. But I would definitely say, okay, I did the thing. I gave it 3 months or 6 months or whatever you think your kind of threshold is. And
so this,
that's a great, I think, a great way to try.
This plays into something that I actually think is really, really kind of strange how this happens, is that when someone's really young, and like when you're, this is actually one of my favorite questions to ask, you know, a founder, an investor, or someone I'm talking to, is that when you're, you know, 17 or when you're just starting college.
You know, to pick a number.
No, okay. So like when you're, no, or even when you're graduating college or something, and someone's like, yo, what do you want to be when you grow up? And you're presented with that question pretty consistently as a young person. What you actually answer, I think, when you start college, like your answer to that question when your dad asks you or your professor asks you or something, I actually think is a really, really important answer. simply because then 30 years later, you can look at it as a, like, where was my inflection point on that? Of, like, you know, I was talking to a, like, successful founder a couple weeks back, and we were talking about this, and I'm like, yo, when you were in, you know, when you were starting college, what did you want to be? He's like, I felt 100% that I wanted to be a surgeon, and I wanted to be a doctor. And it's actually really interesting because he's not a doctor, but what's cool is that then you can go into, like, well, do you still want to be a doctor, or did you figure out that's, you know, not your thing? And, like, how everyone figures that out, everyone has a point where they figure that out, and I actually think that point is, like, a really, really, like, important, like, angle.
Can I add one more thing? You should also come talk to any one of us, because you now have four people, five, who are totally in your court for what you're doing, and that, I think, could go for anyone, honestly.
I love photography.
Say, hey, how'd you do this? What was your first step? What's the thing I do tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning?
Well, you should really talk to Jessica, because that's exactly the transition.
And I just wanted to, I know we got to end, but I wanted to invite you to do an exercise on your own. If you feel inspired, that is very revealing, and to what we're talking about is write your own eulogy. What do you want to be remembered for? It's very powerful. When I did it, it was when I'm like, I got to quit. And realizing that any one of us may be hit by a bus, plus eulogy, you're probably going to do photography.
I was going to say, for when you get hit by a bus, and I didn't know if that was like appropriate, so but a good I guess metaphor. We're going with it.
So, you know, one thing that I've learned about my own 21st century career, whatever you want to call it, is that being an author is basically like this weird Venn diagram of being a hermit, a preacher, and a panhandler. And so, you know, I think you guys, you knew that a book plug was coming, and that's what the panhandler piece is all about. So I would love if you guys check out Uncommon Stock. It's a startup thriller, so it's basically like a startup adventure that you can enjoy from bed with a ton of sex and murder thrown in there. So it's also the...
So like a startup.
Yeah, exactly like a startup. It's even VC-backed. Brad Feld, his new publishing company, is the one behind it.
That doesn't mean the book and the startup is VC-backed, does it?
The startup in the book is VC-backed, and it is being published by a VC-backed publishing company, yes. And we've been really, really lucky. So we launched in the top 10 on Amazon. We have more than 50 five-star reviews, and the startup and tech mixer folks have been kind enough to share the excerpt with you. One thing that I've found is that you know, we haven't spent a dollar on marketing, and it's all been word of mouth and friends and readers. So read it, let me know what you think, review it, tell people about it, and you know, at the end of the day, one of the interesting parts about working in the 21st century is that although people are working much more independently, you know, none of us can succeed alone. So with that in mind, I want to thank all of our fantastic panelists for traveling here and making time in their busy schedules to be with us tonight. And also to John and Ari and Andrew, everyone else at the Mixer, and for you guys who made time in your otherwise very busy Friday evening schedule to join us here.
Thank you.
So we're going to take a 5-minute break and start our next panel. I'd like to welcome you to come back to hear Fred Kaufman speak about conscious business.